Well, good morning, everyone. As someone once said, you don't need your 3D glasses for this one. But this is about time, so this is actually about the fourth dimension. Well, for those of you who have been in practice for a while, if you think back 20 years ago, there was virtually no role for radiosurgery for any of these things, brain metastasis, rarely for AVMs, little for acoustic neuromas, residual tumors, trigeminal neuralgia, anything in the cavernous sinus, anything small, anything that was just observed. And now radiosurgery plays an optional role for all of these things. Well, why did neurosurgery or even radiation oncology even need to change if we look back 20 years? Well, the outcomes were challenging. Things were variable, obviously. The only options we had were to operate or not. Care required a great patient commitment and sacrifice. Over 70 years, to try to create technical masters was still a difficult problem. The response to our typical poor outcomes, if they occurred, was simply to train harder. You've got to try harder, go back to the lab, go to the anatomy lab, not to necessarily do something radically different. And then imaging, cell biology, and computers changed. And to be honest, we ignored some of the most common diseases, such as cancer. And at the time, what neurosurgery said about the new kid on the block was that, well, the tumors would grow back, everything would scar, you know, later resections would be more problematic, young people shouldn't be radiated, it takes too long, it doesn't always work. And what radiation oncology said was, well, this wouldn't work biologically, it made little sense, and listen, we know what we're doing, and it's not radiosurgery. Well, all that was fairly wrong. Well, it's interesting, this change occurred not because of prospective class one randomized trials, which are, as we know, very difficult to do, and there have been actually very few in neurosurgery. The question must have equipoise, and we must believe it. Patients often don't want a random choice. They require a lot of effort. They're difficult to do, and to be honest, we haven't done some. And in fact, there's never been a successfully completed trial of resection versus radiosurgery for anything. So where did the change come from? Well, there has been a little class one evidence, and it relates to radiosurgery versus radiotherapy on the radiation oncology side of the world. There are some technical randomized trials to refine techniques, like how to do trigeminal neuralgia radiosurgery, but these are not in our world in terms of resection options versus radiosurgery. And in fact, this trial for epilepsy, radiosurgery versus resection, was so important to the NIH, it was funded to $18 million, and last year it was stopped because of poor accrual. Even this one did not complete. So we've lived with class two evidence or matched cohort studies, which are easier to do with large databases, and you can draw fairly powerful conclusions. And in fact, we underutilized this technique. And in fact, it was this approach that changed acoustic neuroma management with five non-randomized cohort studies showing the value of radiosurgery for smaller acoustic neuromas. But we really don't even live there. We live at the class three level, which is the majority of our data, which can be valuable if the topic is important, if the data is large, and we ask relevant questions, and we help the reader make decisions, such as this report on stage volume radiosurgery, which was simply a technical new approach to treat large AVMs with very little data, very little outcomes, in fact, and it was widely adopted rapidly. And how did change like that occur? It's because we wanted it to occur, and we needed some other new concept. Let's look at a couple of examples. Vestibular schwannomas were only a surgical resection disease, and now commonly, it's now a disease solved by some kind of radiation. Well, the current questions we should be asking are not necessarily radiosurgery versus resection questions, but why should the cochlea be removed at all? Why do we do translab surgery? Why is facial nerve function preservation difficult? If we're trying to maintain the blood supply to nerves, can we not do this differently by not even touching the blood vessel? If a tumor took years to grow into the brainstem, why does it have to be removed next week? Can it not take years to come out of the brainstem? Why do other things happen after schwannoma surgery? And what's the radiobiology of the response, or even of balance, or the vestibular system? These are the current questions. And of course, patients who now present with newly diagnosed tumors are a very different animal because they have so much available to them and a lot of literature, and this whole web can be quite confusing to them. And in fact, when we look back 20 years ago, the people who told us they knew what they were talking about from a radiobiologic perspective said, this doesn't make sense. These small tumors will not respond to radiation. And so we collected data, and all of us who were participated in this effort now showed that, well, they do respond, and that was wrong. Well, the change that happened was that neurosurgery needed to become comfortable with inactivation rather than a clean scan. And who forced us to be comfortable with that was really our patients who said that was an okay response for them if they went back to work next week and got on with their life. Well, at the same time, the bar was raised, and the new change came about hearing preservation, which was really not an issue 20 years ago. And so how do we save hearing? It's not even clear now how we save hearing. Initially, we thought the cochlear nerve was important. Now we think the cochlea is important. How much radiation we give to the cochlea may be important. Here's less than a certain amount of radiation in a young person with results that, over the short term at least, look interesting. Here's a recent paper from the Michigan Ear Institute showing that if you gave less than 2 units of radiation to the cochlea, nobody lost hearing. So is that possible? Can we give such a low dose to such structures that almost the amazing can happen? Maybe. So the next change that many are working on is, what's the best treatment for tinnitus? What's the best outcome for balance? Maybe it's a resection. Is hearing loss dependent not on even the cochlea, but on the rate of change of hearing? Is there a whole new concept out there? And we believe that there is. It's probably a concept with both drug therapy and radiation modulating each other. And what's the immunology of the response? Well, let's move on to lesioning, because in an elderly population, change is occurring rapidly. And you heard Ali Rezai's presidential address on all the wonderful things happening in functional neurosurgery. Well, when DBS came out in 1997, the question was, does lesioning now make sense? And this is still being asked. So I said, that's a 1997 kind of question. The current question is not that. It's, what do we want anything to do? Whether it's electricity, radiation, ultrasound, now with HIFU, now optogenetics, what do we want this to do? Well, we want it to modulate the cells in a specific area or break up circuits or change the impact of a functional disorder. That's all we want it to do, as long as it works well and it's controllable. And prior to doing radiosurgical treatments in the thalamus, we went to the primate first to see what this would do, and we know it works. The difficulty is making sure that little white dot matches the VIM nucleus of the thalamus. So how would we open this door to everybody in this room? Well, if you look at even a high-quality T2 image of the thalamus, you see that gray blur. No one's ever been able to see the VIM nucleus. But in fact, people are starting to work at 7 Tesla. Even that's not terribly great. But so when will we actually see the thalamic nuclei? Well, we may have seen it a couple of weeks ago. This is a tractographic image at NYU, automatically colored and segmented, and you can now see the corpus callosum, the internal capsule. Here's VIM. We're starting to now to see the breakup of the and segmentation of the individual thalamic nuclei. This may really open the doors for us. And when that happens, of course, we can more comfortably move into behavioral disorders, or at the same time, if we understand the circuitry, we can do things there. Well, AVM radiosurgery changed management, but it's got a problem. It just takes too long. So we know it takes about 3 years for an AVM to occlude. Well, wouldn't it be great if it could occur in 3 months? Is that possible? Well, here's a recent case of ours of an AVM, standard grade 2 AVM, standard dose, treated in June. Here's the September angiogram with complete obliteration at 3 months. The brain looks quite good. Why did this happen? Well, from serendipity comes opportunity. What happened was that the vein occluded. We don't know why, but it did, and the patient was fine, and now this AVM is cured at 3 months. So in order for us to take advantage of this observation and do something about it, we're now theorizing that inflaming the AVM with radiosurgery sets up a paradigm for occlusion, and perhaps what we need to do is develop endovascular techniques to slowly, not quickly, but slowly, perhaps over weeks, thrombose the veins and occlude the AVM. And that's a concept that we're going to explore. Let's move on to the commonest challenge that we have, and these are brain metastases. And I'd like to say that almost everything we thought we knew about this problem was likely incorrect and requiring change. If you look at the role of neurosurgery in brain metastases 20 years ago versus now, for multiple tumors, we didn't have a role in that. Small ones, we didn't have a role in that. We could hardly see them. Brainstem tumors, no role. The elderly, we left them alone. But the small multiple tumor patient is the commonest brain metastasis scenario, and we now participate in the management of these patients. Well, what was wrong about brain metastasis? Well, the clinical trials ignored individual tumor biology. They lumped everything together, lung, breast, renal. These diseases, in fact, have really nothing to do with each other. In fact, even breast cancer subtypes have little to do with each other. And the gospel that we relied upon, showing that resection provided benefit for solitary brain metastasis, the Paschal New England Journal trial, actually read it, you'll see that only one melanoma patient in that study, only two breast cancer patients in that study. And yet we have applied that to virtually everything. And of course, clinical trials have all been about the number of tumors, and in fact, the number of tumors is not really terribly important. the crudest metric of tumor burden, but it's easy because we can count. So in fact, somebody who has 8.5 millimeter metastasis, the total cancer burden is half a cc. You've got 2 centimeter metastasis, you've got 8 cc's of cancer in your brain. What do you think is going to do better? It's actually this patient. Insurance companies won't pay for that patient. They'll pay for this patient. So the 2009 guidelines that were published really look at the past literature, and we are way beyond the guidelines now, even 4 years later. These drugs for melanoma didn't exist then. Breast cancer-targeted therapies, for the most part, didn't exist then. Tarceva's radically changed lung cancers, sorafenib for renal cancer. Now we're doing tumor-bed approaches after resections, routine imaging. We're finding the tumors smaller. This is a totally different animal than it was in the past. And in fact, this large breast cancer series we published in 2010 already had a date because we really didn't look at what's important in breast cancer. In fact, if you look at multiple tumors, when we started to do this in the late 80s, more than one was considered heresy because the dogma was, if you've got two, you've got four, you've got six, you're going to die soon. More than four was in heresy in 2000. More than 10 was heresy in 2005. But, you know, where are we in this continuum? Is there an upper limit? It's really based upon technology. One more brain tumor is five more minutes of radiation in somebody's life. That's all the number means. So here's 10 to 13 metastasis, not melanoma, controlled disease. Median survival, it's not 11 months. It's actually 21 months. It's actually more than single metastasis randomized trials. The reason it's more is that most of the tumors typically in that situation are small. So here's a recent patient of ours. She's 45. She's already had whole brain radiation. She recurs with 26 new tumors. What would we offer this patient? You can see in the cerebellum, midbrain. Most of them are small. This is asymptomatic. What we did was we did 13 tumors one Tuesday, and we brought her back 1 week later, and we did the other 13. We did all 26 because her performance status was normal. At 5 months, 25 or 26 are gone. The largest in the cerebellum now looks like that. She's got normal neurologic function. Why was it achievable? Because she has breast cancer, because we know it responds, because we can technically do this, and we have put this problem away for now while she's being actively treated for her breast cancer. A neurosurgical solution to a problem that we had no solution to this years ago. And the change happened because it's been cost-effective at the same time. So we've all lived on survival curves. We now need to move to a new era, which are going to be biologic response curves. So, for example, this is the response curve of a lung cancer metastasis to radiosurgery in terms of volume. It starts off at 100% of its volume. By 3 months, it's down to half the size. And any new or better idea should change the slope of this curve and make it look like that. If someone comes up with a new idea and the slope looks like this, we shouldn't really adopt it. This is going to be the new era of our understanding. So everything in this disease is changing, and we need to be prepared for that because we have the capability to deal with a lot of change in our specialty. And in fact, the change is happening at about 400 peer-reviewed articles a year. It's the radiosurgery literature. How can we catch up? Well, you've heard a lot about N2QOD, and to accelerate real change in practice on an ongoing basis, in my opinion, it's not going to be through level one randomized trials because, to be honest, we haven't been successful utilizing that. It's going to be with pragmatic, prospective research and databases. And in fact, we need to do the neurosurgical Framingham studies with 10,000 to 100,000 data entries. And Dan Resnick mentioned some of these concepts yesterday in spinal surgery. Even in Pittsburgh, where we had a registry for 25 years, 12,000 entries, it wasn't good enough. It was only local. It didn't talk to anybody. It was limited. And it didn't foster big data analytics. And big data is the new era that can leverage real change and power of our content and influence decision-making. So this is all going to be about large-scale pragmatic research. And our radiosurgery program is now embarked upon a system with continuous prospective data collection every time we interact with the patient. And I can control the security of, you know, who can access the data, who can enter it. Here's 300 prospective entries so far this year, including 19 categories with 47 disorders, the subtypes of gliomas, all the fields we want. We enter the demographics, the referring doctors. Here's the vestibular schwannoma paradigm with the neurologic presentation, but includes tinnitus scores, prior surgical types, COOS scores, hearing, all of this. And this is done every day with every patient as they come in. The treatment results, we monitor complications that occur, the follow-up, and then we do online analytics and benchmarking continuously so we know where we are with this data set. we're going to no longer look into the past, we're going to continuously look into the future. So this is one of the first disruptive technologies. We have many in spine, endovascular, functional. And why did it work? Well, it worked because it was a real solution to complex challenges. It worked over the long term. Patients liked it. It was cost-effective. It was evidence-based. It was widely adopted. It followed the imaging research that parallels everything we do in neurosurgery. It attracted industry. And like many of the wonderful things that we have available, it broke the rules. Thank you very much.